Hello YouTube and welcome to Behind the Wall, presented by the jerky that's always perky, Perky Jerky. As per the usual, I am Thermite917 along with my teammates Probo43 and KaneJr88. It's the weekend we've all been waiting for. Finally, it has arrived and it sure did not disappoint. We're going to relive all the action from the Next Era Energy 250, the NASCAR Racing Experience 300, and of course the main event, the Daytona 500. There's obviously a ton of stuff to discuss tonight, so let's dive right into the Daytona 500 race recap with Tyler. Take it away.
I sure will. We got a lot to cover. So William Byron, he won the pole on the previous Sunday. The strategy starts right away, and it's pretty much split down the middle, really. Some people chose to pit early, and some just stayed out, and they were going to ride it out and wait for as long as possible. Matt DiBenedetto found himself in the lead until the first caution of the afternoon when Corey LaJoie blew a right front, tearing the left side of his face off of the car. They get back rolling, and Kyle Busch finds himself into the lead. But the first contact caution of the day comes when Kurt Busch, old big brother Kurt, wasn't clear, and turn one and two comes down on Ricky Stenhouse Jr. I don't think there was any contact there, but it sent Kurt and his little Monster Energy shit box right around. Poor old Bubba Wallace got hit. He smacked into him. Nobody retired from the race as a result of that incident, but a few were hurt just enough to ruin their days, Bubba and Kurt being those two. They finished the stage. There was no lead changes. Kyle Busch won it. They get back on. The longest run of the day, 42 laps under the green, until a very awkward incident between Casey Mears and Parker Kligerman. Still don't quite know what happened there, but somebody stepped on something in the genitalia area. That caused Casey Mears to be out of the race completely. They re-rack him again. There's a lot of split strategy pit calls going on. Some two tires, some staying out, some four tires. Well, Ryan Blaney, he's up there. He takes control and he wins stage number two. Stage three starts with a 34-lap run until the shot heard around the world when pit stop cycles started as the Rick Ware racing cars, who were basically bottled up behind a pack of cars coming to pit road, stepped on each other's dicks and crashed into the back of all of them that were coming to pit road. Tyler Reddick gets slammed by Cody Ware, and Reddick slams into Jimmy Johnson, all of them with a hefty amount of damage. The only person that actually DNF'd from that incident was Cody Ware, thankfully. But obviously that screwed everybody else for the remainder of their race. They get back rolling and a quick caution comes out. For what, you may ask? Debris. Hello, it's officially NASCAR in 2019. We have to have one of those. Another restart. Finally, let's get this thing going. Kyle Larson blows a tire. And it could have been a really big incident, but luckily they were starting to choo-choo. We re-racked them again. And another tire incident happens when Brad Keselowski has a left rear go and he crashes off of turn number four. Doesn't really hit too hard, but his car is still mangled. Now, we're setting up here with almost 10 laps to go. And right on the restart, all hell breaks loose as Paul Menard jams Matt DiBenedetto in the ass, setting off the inevitable big one. You knew it was coming. It sure created quite a pileup, creating a near 30-minute red flag to clean up all the piss and shit. So they geared up for another restart, and things were looking good. But oh no, they got to the backstretch, and Ricky Stenhouse Jr. couldn't hold himself, jams it in on Kyle Larson, and causes another wreck, taking out Kevin Harvick. Brad Keselowski was involved, Chase Elliott was involved, Alex Bowman was hurt in it. But the only person that actually DNF'd from that was Harvick. Now we're in overtime. Oh right, we couldn't have a green finish because Clint Bowyer, for the second time in a row on a restart on the backstretch, Clint Bowyer completely crosses traffic without looking, turns himself, heads straight into the wall, destroys about everybody in his path. Chase Elliott, Landon Castle gets destroyed. He had no damn brakes, plowed into William Byron. Jamie McMurray was involved for good measure. Poor old Brendan Gaughan. That was the final caution of the race. So now we need to start talking about who's in the lead. Denny Hamlin and Kyle Busch kind of were swapping a little bit back and forth. It was definitely Toyota controlled right there at the end. But Denny Hamlin was in the lead for that moment. And on the final restart, he was able to pull down in front of Kyle Busch and everybody else, hold off all the challengers. Joey Logano made attempts. Even Michael McDowell tried. Ryan Preece had a head of steam, but nobody could do anything. Denny had it. Just enough steam. Held them all off to win his second Daytona 500 over Kyle Busch, Eric Jones in a JGR 1-2-3 sweep. Joey Logano finished fourth. Michael McDowell rounds out the top five. Ty Dillon, Kyle Larson, Ryan Preece, Jimmy Johnson, and Ross Chastain round out the top 10. Holy Lord, so much to say, really. A couple additional stats, 12 cautions for 47 laps. The margin of victory was 0.138 seconds. Average race speed, 137.44 in a race that lasted 3 hours, 45 minutes, 55 seconds, had two red flags that lasted over 20 minutes each. Jesus, that became a hellfest by the end. I don't even know if I did a good enough recap because it just seemed like absolute craziness. But let's give some race ratings. Kane, your voice is needed to be heard. What are you thinking of this race?
What am I thinking of this race? Well, I want to be mad. I really do. Obviously, with JGR finishing 1-2-3 in the biggest race of the year, I would normally be really pissed off right now, but I can't be. And obviously, for very good reason, with J.D. Gibbs passing away last month, it was a really special tribute to see Joe Gibbs Racing run 1-2-3, and then obviously with Denny, you know, in J.D.'s car, the number 11. But aside from that, the finish itself was pretty lackluster compared to the rest of the race. So I would say the first 170-something laps were really solid. I mean, there was not really a whole lot of choo-choo, which is great. There was a lot of side-by-side racing. But then, at the end of the race, everything went, and especially after the Rick Ware Racing crash, it became a shish show, in the words of Brett Griffin and TJ Majors. So, with that being said, I'm going to give the race a 6 out of 10. I'd say it's a pretty fair rating. I could have gone lower, but Nick, what is your rating?
Well, I'm going to go up a notch and give it a 7. I mean, like you said, the first, like, 90% or so of the race was really solid. Guys were being respectful. They actually made the multiple lines work. I was really surprised to see that after the terrible clash where they couldn't get anything going. But they actually tried to do stuff. I don't know if Jim France kind of helped give them some motivation, or it was the hot and slick track, or it was the Daytona 500, but it sure worked out and made for some entertainment for the right reasons. And then we had some entertainment for the wrong reasons, as it turned into a traditional wreckfest-style plate race that we've seen in recent years. I mean, that's racing. That's going for the big old trophy that is the best race of the year. But still, you got to have a little bit of awareness and respect, or it's just not going to be fun for the fans to watch. I mean, it's part of it. I can't get too mad at it. Like Kane said, it was an amazing tribute to J.D. Gibbs at the end for Gibbs finishing 1-2-3. Wasn't the best finish, but we've seen much worse. At least it wasn't controversial like last year with Austin Dillon. So there's really not much to be mad about. I'll just stick with my 7. Tyler, what is your rating?
6.5 out of 10. You ever watch a movie? The premise is skeptical, but you're going to give it a chance anyways. And you start watching it, and you become pleasantly surprised. Wow, this is interesting. And it builds up to the climax, and it eventually gets to the point of conflict, like every goddamn movie you ever see. And the point of conflict was the Rick Ware racing cars banging into cars coming to pit road. And then all of a sudden, shit hit the fan, and the movie becomes nonsensical. And you're just like, what the hell's happening here? Like, it was just so interesting, and then it leads up to the end, and it might not be the worst ending you ever see, but you're almost glad that it's over. And that's kind of how I felt towards the end of this race. I just was like, ugh, let's just end this already. Like, we've been sitting here, the red flags threw such a wrench in things, and it just was becoming not as enjoyable as it looked like it was going to be. So, while I'm not going to sit here and be all pissy and be like, I didn't want to see Denny Hamlin win, I really didn't, but it is what it is. There's good points to it, you guys have already said it, good tribute, happy on that aspect. If we were going to rank this race of the 61 Daytona 500s, I couldn't even tell you. I'll just assume that it probably fits somewhere in the middle and will eventually become obscure because there's nothing terrible but nothing terrific from this race. It just kind of is there. So, you know, we write it down, put it in the books, and is what it is.
Couldn't agree more.
Well, now it's time to hand out some awards for the 2019 Daytona Speed Weeks. And starting it off with that classic boner of the week, you can guess who it is because I was animated about it. Rick Ware Racing! These dumbasses field two cars, one's already bad enough, and you know that that car is guaranteed for at least one caution a race. Oh well, it happened in the Daytona 500, and boy did it set off the craziness that was the rest of the race after that. But DJ McLeod just must have slowed down Cody Ware in his psychotic state, didn't know what was happening, ran him in the ass. Next thing you know, here comes Cody Ware flying into Tyler Reddick, who flies into Jimmy Johnson. BJ McLeod just spinning, doing donuts, probably eating a donut in the grass. Good Lord, it's just pure irony that it was these two morons. It looked like, I don't know, a bulldozer coming through. Like, all of a sudden, you're going to make a big-ass divot. And, well, the divot was Tyler Reddick's ass. So, next award, please.
All right, our next award is the Day from Hell. And, oh, my God, last year's runner-up, Bubba Wallace. Man, he got caught up in somebody else's shit. That, of course, being the spinning Kurt Busch. He just had nowhere to go, pile drove into his left rear, and then got ran into by Jamie McMurray. And his day was pretty much ruined. He managed to run a bunch of more laps with a completely taped up car, and then he just said, fuck it, and pulled into the garage, DNF'd, and he finished in 38th. I feel so bad for him. I mean, he was so excited before the race, like, yeah, we're going to have fun, it's going to be great, and then this shit happens.
Yeah, he had some aftershocks.
Damn right he did. Next award.
All right, the next award is a classic. It is the
Straight Jacket Award!
And it goes to the Next Era Energy 250 truck race. What in the hell did we watch? We laughed, we cried. It was just pure insanity out there. Just to kind of pinpoint some of the highlights, it didn't take long. On lap one or two, Natalie Decker's truck caught fire after she cut a tire, right after David Gilliland had to pull out of the draft because he had a flat tire, right after Brian Doza cut his own tire and hit the wall in turn one. It was just crazy. Like, things were happening left and right. Then things calmed down, and we got to the stage two finish. That was a good one. Sauter making some bold moves out there. Then we had the big one with Jordan Anderson smacking the wall really hard, taking out a bunch of trucks. Then Corey Roper, we thought maybe he was going to have a good day up front. And then, no! He can't hold on to it due to bad handling or just inexperience. He slams the inside wall. Todd Gilliland pushes Harrison Burton into the wall, collects himself. Then Timothy Peters and Clay Greenfield go for a spin. And then, just so appropriately, Clay Greenfield's hood goes up with the damage he had. He can't see. He goes flying through the infield, barely finds his pit. And then we have another big one with Gus Dean overreacting and collecting Ben Rhodes and a bunch of others. Then we get to overtime, and, you know, you think, you know, there's not many trucks left. I think we can get to the finish now. No! Bobby Gerhart cuts across the nose of Austin Wayne Self, goes into the wall. And then we have a first-time winner with Austin Hill. You know, it was just every crazy thing that could happen happened. Nine trucks were running at the finish. That was the least amount ever in the truck series. Another record was it was the longest truck race in terms of miles in history at 277.5. So, Gander Outdoors Truck Series, or NGOTS, you must be freaking crazy to tear up that many trucks in a single race. I know your series got a new sponsor, and I know you were just trying to impress them, but man, you sure went out in a blaze of glory in your debut. Straight jackets to every single driver in that race, even the ones who kept their trucks clean, because it was just that crazy. Ah! And man, you know, you think that's crazy. We have a bunch of cigars to hand out. Take it away.
Yeah, we sure do. And coming off of that crazy recap of that race, there was plenty of people who got cigars. First one, obviously, going to the winner, Austin Hill. His first race for Hattori Racing, he gets his first career win. I certainly expected to see him in victory lane at some point in 2019, but definitely not in the first race, especially not a plate track. But man, he did real solid in that 02, got the ride. A lot of people disagree with it as far as Hattori Racing's handling of the whole situation. Hey, sponsorship goes sometimes, and the fact of the matter is he brought a sponsor, and yet he won. So it really doesn't matter. That's how you prove you belong, and he certainly did. Also, great blocking on that last lap to hold off Grant Enviger. Such a great performance right there. Then you got Ross Chastain. You can always count on Mr. Underdog to do good things, and that's exactly what happened. He drove the 45 Nice entry and finished third. So nice job, Ross. Then you got Josh Rayom. He finished sixth, his first career top 10. Never even had a top 15 up to this point. Typically, Josh just putting around in the back, seven laps down, 50 miles an hour off the pace per race. But that didn't happen here. He just survived and, well, did what he needed to do. So nice job, Josh. Then the final cigar for the Truck Series. I have to pause for a moment because this is so incredible. Angela Ruck.
What?
How in the hell is she getting a cigar for something good? Now, I don't think she'll do anything with the cigar. I'm assuming she'll give it to her husband or maybe trade it in for another coat of spray tan because that's her thing. Or just talk about it on her new upcoming reality series, The Ruck Life. It seems like a terrible porn star documentary. But, you know, the thing about it is, she finished eighth. I mean, she actually didn't do that bad. She was up in the top five at one point. Like, she legitimately drove up there. She had an engine problem. Had it not been for that, she probably could have been in the mix. It's just so baffling to think of. And yeah, she bought that ride for Nemco, but it was a decent truck. She brought it home in one piece. Don't even think it had a scratch on it. And for Angela Ruck, that is a pure miracle. It's hard to hate on her for that. So, nice job. I guess you deserve a spray tan this week, so go treat yourself to one. So, now we move on to Xfinity. We have more miracles. Take it away.
The first one goes to Michael frickin' Annette.
What?
Oh my god, like, did I read that right? Did Michael Annette win a race? That just can't be real. But he did it. It was one of the most boring races I've ever seen, but he was the leader at the checkered flag, and that's what counts. He actually got it done. How does that happen? Like, he has struggled so much over the years. Like, think back, like, over 8 years ago, he was with Rusty Wallace Racing, didn't do anything there, then went to Cup, sure as hell didn't do anything there. Dale Jr. took a chance on him, as well as Pilot Flying J, because, you know, he has the money. But still, I guess that helps if you can actually put a win together, which he did. So, I mean, you can't help but be happy for him. Hopefully, he does have a good year. He's got Travis Mack atop the box, and he's going to get things done this year. I don't know. We'll see. Hopefully, he better. Anyway, moving on, Ryan Sieg gets a cigar. He finished fourth, and, you know, it's not really a surprise to see him running up there because, like Ross Chastain, he gets a lot done with not much equipment. But he brought that Larry's Lemonade, which I guess is a spinoff of Leslie's Lovely Lagers. He brought it home with a great finish, as did his teammate, Jeff Green. He finished seventh. So that's a double top 10 for RSS Racing. Jeff Green is just a total surprise because, like, he's been on his way out of the series for, like, the past 10 or 15 years, and he still finds a way to get a top 10. So maybe he lost some weight, gave it to Brendan Gaughan. But to wrap up the cigars, because I think we need to, Kane, take away the Cup cigars for us, please.
All right, I will do that. Our first Cup cigar obviously goes to Denny Hamlin, his second career Daytona 500 victory. Very fitting tribute for the late J.D. Gibbs. And then Michael McDowell. How about that? He was caught up in a late incident, suffered very minor damage, and he still finished in fifth. How cool is that? Way to go. And then Ty Dillon, he came home in sixth. He was involved in a couple of incidents as well, but he still made it through. And as was Ryan Preece. Yes, he is in his first full season driving the 47 for JTG Doherty. He came home in eighth. I gotta say, that's pretty damn impressive. I don't know how he's gonna do in the 47 this year, but he definitely made a statement early on. And Ross Chastain, that's right, he is getting another cigar because he finished in 10th driving the 15 car for Premium Motorsports. That is his first top 10 in the Cup Series. So, Mr. Mellon, congratulations, you get a twofer. And then our final cigar, it goes to somebody who unfortunately crashed out, but damn did he have a hell of a performance. Old Dibby, Matt DiBenedetto, he led the most laps in his very first start for Levine Family Racing. Now, granted, he got spun out by Paul Menard to trigger the first big crash of the day, but he definitely made a statement, and who knows, this might be a good fit for him this season, driving the 95. So, congratulations to Dibby and all of the recipients of our cigars, and that is it for our awards.
Bye!
Bye!
Later.
Well, now it's time for one of our favorite segments of the show, the best paint schemes of the week, and we sure do have a montage to take a look at some of the best that we saw. This particular montage will be dedicated to a very important person who we lost during Speed Weeks, the greatest NASCAR designer of all time, Mr. Sam Bass, and it is only appropriate. So this one's for you, Sam. And unfortunately, we have to follow that up with the worst paint schemes of the week. Every week, there is always multiple. This week, we've got three paint schemes to talk about, so let's just go ahead and get it started and get it over with. Please, take it away, Nick. We had one from Truck Series.
The first one goes to Ben Rhodes, and first of all, I don't know why he's in the 99 now. I don't know why he couldn't just keep his 41 or go back to the 27. He's been switching around a lot. But anyway, his paint scheme sucks. I don't know what ThorSport is doing. They're trying to go for some team unity, and they all kind of have a similar base design going on, except for Crafton. But that doesn't work, first of all. They kind of have something going on around the greenhouse with the little tube lines going out above the tire, trying to make it look all nice and technical and fast and stuff. And then you got the little Menards yellow slapped on the quarter panel. But, you know, I could almost deal with that. Then we get to the race. And they slapped this yellow square behind the number for no reason. I don't know if NASCAR made them do that because the number didn't stand out enough, but it looks even worse. It's just this whole jumbled mess of colors that are slapped on there. It's like a Carolina nut designed it. A nut from Carolina. Let's just move on, please, to the next one.
All right. Our next bad paint scheme is from the Cup Series. It's the Oscar Mayer Wienermobile. I'm just kidding. It's Ryan Newman's Oscar Mayer Deli Fresh Ford. What the hell is this thing? First of all, you got a red nose. It's like, okay, you're Rudolph? No. Okay, and then it's got some kind of weird, like, comic book dots or whatever. And it fades off. And you got all these little sandwiches scattered around behind the number on the doors. Like, what?
Is that Cody Coughlin's sandwich?
I know, right? I mean, they do look like turkey subs, to be honest, so maybe they are. And then it fades back into red once again when it hits the quarter panels. And then you got the big old Oscar Mayer logo slapped on the quarter panels themselves. It looks so weird. You couldn't put just a simple design back there? It would have looked a whole lot better. But no, we gotta slap a bunch of sandwiches, a bunch of turkey subs back there. I'm surprised y'all didn't just sign Cody Coughlin instead of Newman. God.
He would have eaten the car.
He would have eaten the car. It's damn right he would have. Anyways, moving on to the next atrocity. Tyler, what is that?
Yes, the last paint scheme of the week that we have to talk about in a negative fashion. Corey LaJoy, the number 32 Old Spice Ford for Go Fast Racing. Whoa, wow. Holy hell, this paint scheme's weird. Okay, it's not enough that it's just Old Spice and, you know, they do some weird little things. You know, they got all your commercials riding off on the beaches with your horses and your flowy hair. Yeah, that's right. That's exactly what we see here. Lots of flowy hair down the side. And you know what? It actually kind of looks like a cool design. But hold on. Oh, never mind. I don't have to tell you to hold on. You see the glaringly obvious fucking face on the hood. Corey himself is plastered to a size that is just pure creep. That's what this is. This is every pedophile ever on the front of this car. I'm sorry, Corey, but that's what you come off like. Your mouth is in place of the grill. It looks weird, cringy, awful. There's no way in hell we were letting this paint scheme slide. If he's not there, this might have been a best paint scheme of the week with a little bit of creativity there. But come on, you just can't do that. That is not a paint scheme. It's terrible. You deserve to have the left side of your face blown off, the right side. I wish the whole thing would have gotten destroyed. I wish you would have been underneath Eric Amarola when that big crash happened, because then your face would have been obscured and nobody would have known it was ever there. You come back to the sport, Old Spice, and this is what you do? No. Where's your red? Come on. You had an opportunity to do something really cool. Instead, this is in my nightmares. Thank you.
I don't know. I kind of like it.
Hell no. No, you don't. No. No, you do not, Nick. I will vote you off this podcast.
And as someone who has designed Old Spice cars on NASCAR 15, I am fucking ashamed.
Exactly. We'll post a picture of that right here. Exactly. That's nice right there. I like that. But hold on a second. We're not exactly done yet. We might be done talking about paint schemes themselves, but of course, we have to have this funny little thing and trend continue from last year. We talked about this. We don't want additional decals that are unnecessary in the goddamn contingency area, but oh, they came back with the vengeance, RTA and your goddamn logos. NASCAR Heat! Are you kidding me? And it's not just one, it's two. To promote their Heat website and the stupid ass NASCAR Heat Esports Pro League. Oh my god, that is a discussion in its own. Get the hell out of here with your mediocre ass game. Exactly. Some teams did a really piss poor job of having a massive logo there, or even with Corey LaJoy's car having to have a white box behind it. Just disgusting. I mean, I guess we have no choice but to accept it, but it still doesn't make it any less awful. Ugh. We're going. See you next week.
All right, it's time to recap the fantasy results from the Daytona 500. And son of a bitch, guess who won? Guess who frickin' won again? Kane. He picked Joey Logano, who finished fourth, but got him 42 points, and he got the win. Damani came home second, picking Keselowski, who finished 12th, barely held on for all it was worth at the end, but he only got him 32 points. Then I came home third. I picked Ryan Blaney. He won a stage, but he finished 31st, so he got me 22 points. Then Tyler, he took a swing with Paul Menard, and it did not pay off. He finished 29th and got him only 8 measly points. So now we move on to Atlanta, where the new rules package will take effect for the first time. And Tyler, you are picking first, so who are you going with?
Well, I'm not going to get drugged at the back of the Menard store and beaten to a bloody pulp this time, so I'm going to take Kevin Harvick.
He raced me like a clown all day.
Do I need a reason? I don't even give a damn if there's new package and all sorts of stuff. I need to just take somebody strong, get me some points, put me back up. I don't care if it's week one. I don't like to be down. I don't like to be last. And that's Damani or Nick's job, because Kane can't falter any goddamn time. So, all right, that's who I'm taking. Nick, who's your pick?
All right, well, I don't really want to go with him, but I picked him a lot last year. He's kind of a safe bet. I'm going with Kyle Busch.
You can't beat that stuff. stupid.
I mean, this package is probably going to suit him, and he's good at Atlanta, so that's a double threat right there. So he's going to bring it home, and we don't want him to, but I think he will, especially after not getting that Daytona 500 win. He's going to be fired up. Damani, who's your pick?
God bless it.
Thank you, Damani. Kane, who's your pick?
Well, you guys chose the other two members of the Big Three, so I'm going to take the last one that's remaining and take stage winner, MTJ, Martin Truex Jr. Yeah. Obviously, we know how good he is at mile and a half tracks, and now that he is with Joe Gibbs Racing, I feel like that kind of dominance will continue. MTJ. All right, and that wraps up pretty much our second episode of Behind the Wall for the 2019 season. We hope you enjoyed listening. As always, for Damani HD, who knows what the hell has happened to him. He was, last we heard, he was off smoking a J during the Daytona 500, so at least he was with us. For Pro Bowl 43, oh man, he sucks at fantasy this week. For Thermite 917, who won't stop spilling his ice cream on himself. And for myself, Kane Jr. 88, who would rather consume an entire 12-pack of ice-cold Busch than to watch another Denny Hamlin win in the Daytona 500. This has been Behind the Wall. You've been behind the wall. And thank you for listening.
All right, the next award is the classic. That was not how I wanted to do it. Right after Brian Doza hit the outside wall. Shut up! I'm doing it right! It's okay!
And we Doza, were going so well. That was a classic Matthew Bottle job.
I recovered it. Like, I did my little pause and recovered like Tyler likes us to do, and then you start laughing!
Sorry. It happens. Don't screw up next time.
Nice recap. You drag like Kane.
Oh, I didn't try to drag. I tried to cover every goddamn thing! There was so much! There was 7 cautions at stage 3! Piss off!
Yeah, and you were one of them.
Oh, wow. Thank Dad for your support.
Bobby Gerhart cuts Austin Hill off. Cuts Austin Wayne himself off. Shut up! Bobby Gerhart cuts Austin. Damn it!
Austin, damn itself.
Yeah, the first one goes to Ryan Sieg.
It doesn't! He's just one of...
What? Oh, Jesus, I skipped one.
Yeah, you did.
I was so
and
eager.
It's a huge one, too.
I wasn't used to seeing his name there, I guess. So you're saying you would have rather had LaJoy's face be in Almirola's ass?
No!
Oh, my God. Thanks for that visual.
Oh, Jesus.
And for myself, Kane Jr. 88, who would rather drink himself to death. This has been Behind the Wall, presented by Perky Jerky.
Hold on. Hold on.
What?
That took quite a turn there.
That took a turn. Yeah.
Jesus. You would rather drink
then
yourself
see
to death.
Denny Hamlin win, right?
Because you didn't say anything else afterwards. You were just like, oh, I'd rather drink myself to death. Like, whoa.
That's actually
And for
a good
Kane
point.
Jr. 88, I have crippling depression.
Jesus. I'm not saying don't stick with that, but say something else afterwards.
This has been Behind the Wall, presented by Perky Jerky. Grab a bag today at your local Whole Foods. If there's one near you. So that's... Yep, oh my God, I'm blowing up. I'm bottling it! What's going on out there?
No.
No, like I hear all these noise from my parents' room, and I... No, not
you. I'm hearing all these voices. I don't know where they're coming from.
It's like people are talking.
No, it's not talking.
Now I'm really confused.
Jesus Christ. Did you ask the money?
Yeah. No.
Of course you didn't. Well,
I was eating ice cream.
Ice cream!
Wow. I mean, I guess I shouldn't be surprised. But I'm just, you know what? The one thing I am surprised about is that you haven't made like a noise like, oh wow, that's cold, because I would have expected you to drop some ice cream on yourself.
No, I'm
done that's
now.
What you do. Well, I bet you are. Probably had your nice little bowl with the fudge swirl. Probably had to have your mom come in and give you a napkin, maybe dab off your cheek.